بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. So what we're going to do today is basically some sort of an example, or actually I brought a couple of examples of practical applications of the utilization of what we call the F chart method for rating the performance of solar collectors, which means that you have in hand solar collectors and you need just to see how much they are going to do the required work of heating used utilizing solar energy. Basically, we're talking about solar heating as one of the common applications, and water heating specifically is what we're looking at. The presentation you see here is what we have covered last time, that started with talking about the active solar energy systems, and actually there are active systems and there are passive systems. The active systems are the systems in which you are bringing a device for the utilization of solar energy, like a solar collector, like a PV panel. Now you are doing something and you brought a device to convert the coming solar energy into heating fluid, and then you use the heat fluid for different purposes. It could be space heating, it could be domestic water heating, drying, and so on. On the other hand, what we call passive solar heating systems are the systems in which you are not using any devices at all, like the sun rooms, which are located in many, many houses in the West, that they have a room which is made, or a big area of its walls are made of glass, so that that glass would utilize the greenhouse effect and do that required heating for the room without any devices from outside coming in. You'll find that in many, many cold countries, they have in their houses a room which is having basically the whole walls of glass and sometimes part of the ceiling as well. And they use that in winter so that they can make use of the solar or the sunshine whenever the sun shines to heat the place. Flat plate collectors are typical devices which are widely used for heating, be it heating of basically fluids. So be it the fluid is a liquid or a gas. We talked about solar collectors already, and you have seen this figure last time that shows how flat plate solar collectors can be installed on top of a roof of a house. The tilt angle here is not optimized. So this is, it depends on the roof itself. You know that they do the roofs with certain slopes so that the ice does not accumulate and make an additional weight on top of the house in the cold season, but the ice can just be limited in the quantities that can accumulate on the surface. And here's talking about what we call the low iron glass so that you can have better characteristics of transmissivity in. And talking about the fluid which is used, water is typically the best fluid, but the problem is water freezes at 0 degrees Celsius, and some countries the temperature go well below zero. So for this case, either there is some sort of a critical value of the radiation that the whole collector is drained when the temperature goes below certain value, or you can replace water or add some components like antifreeze components to the water, like what happens to our radiators, for example, for the cars. They add the antifreeze so that water would not solidify. It will not be turning to ice when the temperature gets very low. And examples of these are the ethylene glycol, which is toxic, and the propylene glycol. They mix it with water and they have to replace the whole thing every 5 years because of the degradation in the unit. But whenever you are using, as I mentioned last time, whenever you want to use ethylene glycol, you don't use it directly in the domestic water that you are using, but you are going to have a closed loop for the solar collector. It heats that ethylene glycol solution, and then that hot solution is exchanging heat in a heat exchanger with water, so that the water can get heated. I'm talking about the pure water that we are using for washing or so. Solar collectors for air are basically used for two purposes. One of them is space heating in some cases, and the other one is drying of food crops. For example, you are getting crops and you need them to be dried. And one of the ways that people do drying economically is by heating the air by the solar energy and then having the air passing through the crops to take the moisture out of the crops and dry them. Normally, whenever we're talking about air, then the surfaces that we have should be finned surfaces because air has a low heat transfer coefficient. And you need to rectify that by using extended surfaces, as you have studied earlier in heat transfer. The solar collectors can be glazed, which means that they have glass cover or more, or they can be unglazed, so there's no glass cover at all. Whenever there's no glass cover, then we don't have to worry about that transmissivity, and more energy will be falling into the absorber surface. But the losses are going to be high because you are not reducing losses by convection and radiation to the sky. And accordingly, the unglazed solar collectors can be used, but for low temperature applications. Very good example of that is the swimming pools. Then, when we are talking about solar collectors, you don't expect to have a system that's going to use a single solar collector, but normally it is an array of solar collectors. And what you see here is a typical example of how these solar collectors can be connected in parallel so that you can heat a higher flow rate of the fluid to the required temperature. That also is a cross-sectional of view of solar collector where you can see the different components in. We already talked about that several times, and we just made the description of this figure last time, that we have absorbing plate, which is normally painted in black to absorb as much energy as possible. It resembles or approaches the operation of a black body or characteristics of a black body. And these are the tubes on top of it. Normally, you try to make these tubes made of copper because copper is a very good conductor, so it will be effectively transferring the heat from the absorbing plate to the fluid inside. The fluid, as it enters into a header and then distributed into pipes. After passing through the pipes and being heated by receiving heat from the absorber plate, then another header would be on the other side and the hot water is collected and taken out. One or more glass sheets are going to be there. And definitely in the back of the absorber plate, there's a layer of insulation so that it minimizes the heat losses to the surroundings. Here we have a couple of connections of the solar collectors into different types of tanks. One of them is indirect heating, which is the one we see to the right here. We have a closed loop of the solar collector that could be having a mixture of water and ethylene glycol. So it gets heated in a closed loop. The hot fluid is going to enter here from the top. It will enter into a coil inside the heat exchanger, where it exchanges heat with domestic water, which is coming in as at low temperature, leaving at high temperature, and you are heating the water here or the domestic water indirectly. Why? Because you don't want the domestic water to have any traces of the ethylene glycol, so that you are making two separate cycles this way, and you are pumping the fluid here to the solar collector, and then the pumping effect will make the water circulating inside this closed circuit. Other collectors are called thermosiphon collectors, where basically you don't need a pump at all there. But what you do, you rely on natural convection. You rely on the effect of buoyancy. And that sometimes is the case with air drying as well, so that you rely on temperature-induced density gradients that would make the hot fluid lighter, and then it moves up, and it is replaced by the cold fluid in a natural circulation that can happen to the air. And as you see here, the figure to the left, the natural circulation is happening to water. And the tank is having some sort of stratified or having some sort of layers, hot fluid on the top and cold fluid at the bottom. Also, this is the PVT kind of collector where basically we have electricity generation during the PV panel that we have on the top. The PV panel gets heated, efficiency decreases. To maintain its efficiency, we try to cool it down. So the idea was to cool it down by a coil of water passing in so that the PV panel will get cooled down in temperature and then will retain its efficiency, whereas water is going to be heated. So we are just making two benefits here or killing two birds with one stone, that we are doing electric generation and we are doing thermal energy or heating of the water. And there's some research that has been done in the last couple of years about using this water, heating it to a moderate temperature that make it useful for not only for domestic heating, but also for desalination of seawater. This is how the whole cycle is to be collected so that you can have a certain system for electric storage and then a system for thermal energy storage, which is from the bottom of that PVT collector. Evacuated tube collectors are used normally whenever you are looking for higher temperature. Why? Because we are trying to eliminate the losses in these collectors so that the vacuum in the tubes is going to suppress convection heat transfer, minimize conduction to the minimum, and accordingly, the kind of energy output or energy lost will be much less, and the energy gain is going to bring the fluid to higher temperature. We already talked about in chapter 6 of the book about the solar plate collector, evacuated tube collectors. And here you have an absorber surface where you can have fluid transporting in tubes in a U-tube sort of direction or using a heat pump. And these are typical arrangements of the evacuated tube collectors, be it using some sort of a header here or some sort of, actually there are a couple of headers in this manifold. One of them is for allowing the cold fluid to come in and be distributed to the tubes. The other one is the hot fluid leaving the tubes and going out of the system. And this is why you can see a couple of pipes here. There are certain pipes to the inlet and there's certain pipes from the exit. Or it can be operating with a heat pipe. And we talked about the heat pipe and how the alcohol or the fluid within the heat pipe is moving up and down. And it's moving very quickly up and down, like evaporation, condensation, and so on. And then it heats a fluid which is passing through this condenser of the heat pipe or the copper pulp that we have there, so that it remains hot. And as the cold water passes in, the water gets heated. It can be a channel like this for the fluid to move through. Or it can be a big tank like this one, where basically water is kept out unheated in this tank. So the evacuated tube collectors or even the flat plate collectors can be having like a manifold on the top of it like this, so that the fluid goes in and out. And this is normally happens when you have several units of this operating together. And then you have a storage tank that serves several solar collectors together. Or every one of the collectors can come with its own tank. This is the case if you have one or two collectors to be connected and you don't want to have a separate storage tank, then the collector with its tank would be there. We talked about the issue of the evacuated tube collectors and heating in a U-tube shape. So we have either this or the heat pipes to be used. And the temperature remains high for a certain number of days that would vary from season to season, but it will tell us what, if you are looking for a certain temperature, then how many hours of the day this temperature can be reached or exceeded in the solar collector. And how to be calculating it, are going to go through a detailed examples that talked about this kind of calculation method. The method that we are going to consider today is called the F-chart system. I talked about that quickly last time, but today we need to take a couple of examples that describe this method. Solar characteristics are going to be considered in terms of the solar angles, the insulation, which is basically, and by the way, there is insulation and there is insulation, and the difference is this. If it is O, then we are talking about the solar energy coming from the sun. If it is U, it means that the materials of low thermal conductivity that we try to use for reducing the energy or forbidding or trying to eliminating energy which is being lost. And be careful about using these two words. Temperatures are not the same. They vary within the day and they vary over the year. The calculation of the required sizing or rating of a solar collector cannot be done by a single calculation because changes are there all the time. So we can do it on a single calculation. That means that it's not accurate at all. Or we can overdo it by doing calculations minute by minute over the year, which is too much to do. And it's been agreed that it can be either monthly or daily or hourly basis calculations. If you are looking for long-term applications or long-term utilization like solar heating or solar cooling that you are going to put a collector on top of a house or beside the house, then the monthly would make the best kind of option for that. And you are going to get average value over the month, over the year, and then you can see there are some times and the system is going to overperform. Sometimes it will just be adequately performing, and that's what you expect. Computer simulations have been utilized heavily using one of the very famous program, which is called TRANSIS. It's basically about transient analysis of solar collectors, and it has been utilized to generate empirical equations that are used in the F-chart method. So the F-chart method, the letter F, it represents a fraction of heating load, which is provided by the solar energy. This is something that sometimes we refer to as solar fraction or kusur shamsiya. So part of the load that we have for heating can be given by the solar collector, and the rest can be done by any conventional system. The conventional system could be electric heating, or it could be, as I mentioned earlier, you might have a boiler which is generating hot water using burning fuel, and then you can rely on that as well. If you want the system to be totally operating with solar energy, then definitely storage is going to be there, and the solar system size is going to be big, which means that you are going to put bigger investment of the money. In addition, your payback period is going to be longer. And the example that, or one of the examples that we have today, is going to address this thing. I put all the calculations in an Excel sheet, and I will show you that the value of F, if we need it higher and higher, you need to increase the number of collectors where you can reach for a fraction of one, which means that overall total heating is done by the solar energy. But this is going to cost us because you are going to use more and more collectors. The F-chart method is providing us with a parameter F, which is the solar fraction or the fraction of heating provided by the solar energy to the total heating need. And this is given in terms of two dimensionless parameters, X and Y, or capital X and capital Y. One of them is taking care of the heat loss from the collector, or the ratio of the heat loss from the collector to the load, heating load that we want. And the other one is taking care of the energy input from the sun over the month, where N here is the number of days in the month divided by the load. The parameters that we see here are parameters that you have seen earlier. FR is a modified loss coefficient. UL, it's the overall loss coefficient, overall heat transfer coefficient for the collector. AC is the collector area, or the area of the several collectors that you are using. Delta T is a time duration. Normally it is given in terms of month. So what we do, we multiply the number of hours into the the number of days, and then you can get that. Ref T ref is a reference temperature. Typically, this reference temperature has been agreed to be 100 degrees centigrade. TA is the ambient air temperature, and this value is a variable. It changes from day to day based on which day of the year we are in. L is the heating load which is needed. And then for the Y, the FR, tau alpha are the parameters of the solar collector. AC, again, the area. HT is the incident energy on a tilted surface. L is the load, and N is the number of days in a month. So this is just some sort of identification with FR, UL, where FR, basically we're talking about FR dash. It's a, basically some sort of a correction for the FR value. And the correction here is based on the type of setup that you have. You have a heat exchanger, which would be associated with a storage system, where the storage system can be linked to the collector, but not a part of it, or it can be a part of the collector. And for both cases, there are two equations that represent that. So the FR dash is calculated from the value of FR of the collector, and it is modified based on the heat exchanger characteristics, which is connected to the storage. If it is separated from the collector, but linked to it, which means that physically it's not up, it's not on the top of the collector as we have seen earlier, but it is a separate collector placed aside, then this is the expression that can be used for it. Whereas if it is an integrated part of the collector, then this equation is going to be used for it. This F dash is needed for the calculations of the dimensionless parameters X and Y, as you can see it here in these two equations, or these two defining equations. The factor phi, actually FR is FR into phi. Phi basically is what you see here in this bracket or that bracket. It's it may have a default value, if not given by the manufacturer of the collector or the testing agency, it can be taken as 0.95. Some of them just put it as 0.6 or 0.97, 0.96 or 0.97. If not, then the value is 0.95. The FR tau alpha can be given as 0.93 FR dash into the tau alpha. As I mentioned earlier, extensive computer simulations by Transys have been done to get an expression of F as a function of Y and X. And it has been obtained one equation here for the case where you are using solar collectors to heat liquids, water typically, and one for solar collector that is being utilized for heating air. So based on the fluid that you have, you can take either one of these functions that represent F. General analysis of the F chart would indicate that if you are having fluids with high flow rate, the collector becomes more efficient. But there is a limit for the high flow rate because sometimes the flow rate is too high that the effect of heating can diminish after a high flow rate value. For example, you are increasing it from a value X1 to a value X2, and it becomes more effective. And so, and you keep on doing that, increasing the flow rate until high flow rate, it means that the delta T that you are going to get a benefit from is going to diminish, and it's some, you reach for some sort of asymptote that, that there's no effective heating for this high flow rate. You need to reduce the flow rate to feel the heat a little bit. The storage is typically 75 liters per meter square of the collector area. Some people would use less than that. Some people would use higher than that. If this is the case, then they have to do correction for the size of the storage in their calculations, because the F chart method has been made assuming that there's a typical storage of 75 liters for every meter square. It can be a tank of water in case of water heating systems, or it can be a tank with pebbles, which are small pieces of rocks, for example, or special material, if you are talking about storage of hot air. the F values can be calculated accordingly. It can be generated in a figure like that, which means that you can use either the equations that we have shown before or use figures like that to get the value of F based on X and Y, either for gases or, for liquid heating or for air heating. This is for liquid heating, and this one is for air heating. Normally, when we do that, instead of going to the figures every now and then, what we do, you may do something like what I did in the example. You just put it in Excel, you write the equation once, and then you don't have to go to the figures and obtain corresponding values of F. You just substitute the values of X and Y right away. This is basically what we need to look at or focus on in our class today. We have a couple of examples. One of them is asking us to calculate the thermal energy that we would collect using a south-facing liquid solar collector, which is tilted at an angle. Beta is 45 from the horizontal. This is going to be done on the month of March with climatic variables that shows an average air temperature of March as 6 centigrade. The H radiation falling on the system is 12 megajoules per meter square. This is the average. KT, which is H over H naught, is 0.62. Ground reflectivity is 0.2. And this is a city at an altitude, at a latitude of 38 degrees north. There is a heat exchanger that's being used where the heat exchanger effectiveness is 0.7. We are using a fluid. It's not water here. It's a fluid. It could be water and ethylene glycol mixture where the CP is 3,500 joules per kilogram Kelvin. The fluid has a mass flux. A mass flux is the mass flow rate per unit cross-sectional area. So it has a mass flux G of 0.014 kilogram per second per meter square. The FRUL and the FR tau alpha are basically characteristics of the solar collector. And then the collector area is 10 meters square. The monthly heating load, we need heating load of about 2,500 megajoule. It's March, so the average day is day number 75, which could be 17 March if it's a normal year, 16 March for a normal year, or 15 March for a leap year. Leap year is the year where the number of days in February is 29. And this day, day number 75, is a representative of the month of March for the average value. We're looking for the thermal energy. So what we do, we start by trying to estimate the required quantities for the solar radiation. Basically, what we are looking for H on a tilted surface, HT, and HD, which is needed for the HT calculation. So we need basically to estimate how much energy is falling into the tilted surface with an angle of 45. March 16, or a day N is equal to 75, we can calculate the declination angle, which is delta. And then we have the relation between the diffuse to global insulation, which is HD over H. We know the value of H, so we can get the diffuse component here based on this equation, which is the typical equation that we have in the book. You can calculate the value of HD. We have the sunrise or sunset hour being calculated by this expression, cosine minus 1 tan L tan delta, 88 degrees. The value of RB can be calculated, which is the ratio of beam radiation to the radiation on a horizontal surface. And the value is being calculated here. Then the value of R bar, which is R bar basically is the ratio between HT and H, with HT is the solar radiation on a tilted surface over the value of H on a horizontal surface. So from this, we can calculate the value of HT. This is, as you can see here, it's a function of the beam component And the 1 minus hd over h is nothing but h of the beam component over h. And you know that beam component plus diffuse component is the total component of h falling. So the first term here is the beam component of the radiation. The second one is the diffuse component of the radiation. You can see hd here. And the last one is taking care of the ground reflection. Accordingly, the value of r bar can be calculated, from which we can estimate what is the value of ht, or the tilted radiation on, or the radiation on the tilted surface at 45 degrees. So this is the radiation falling in. Now we are in position to calculate the values needed for the capital X and capital Y for the F expression. FR dash into UL, as you can see it here, it's FR UL into that correction factor phi. And here that the collector is a built-in part of the storage, is the heat exchanger is directly connected to the collector. So we're using that expression here. So FRUL are already given to us. G is the mass flux, CP is the flow rate, and epsilon is the effectiveness of the heat exchangers. All of these values are given. And accordingly, this calculated FR dash into UL is being calculated here. FRUL into phi, and phi here is estimated to be 0.97. So FR dash UL is equal to 3.4. FR dash into tau alpha, according to the equation that we used earlier, it's given here as substitution here, and the value is 0.79. Now you can substitute the values in X and Y. And I have to warn you here that for the Y, there is a missing term in that expression here, which actually they built it in the calculation of H. But it's actually here we should have an expression N, which is the number of days in the month. So actually this is basically what is being missing in this expression here. I should have put, or it should have been with capital N here, which is the, for March, it is 31. So this is the basically the FR dash. This is the into tau alpha. This is the area of the collector. This is the value of H on a tilted surface. And this is the number of days. And here, this is the load, which is the consumption of the users of the hot water. So the value of X has been specified here. The value of Y has been specified here. You substitute this X and Y into the expression of F, and then you get a value of 0.84, which means that 84% of the energy needed can be satisfied by the solar collectors. And this value, or the thermal average thermal energy over the month, that can be obtained, or that can be satisfied by the solar collector, is 0.84 of the load. The load is 2,500 megawatts and megajoules, and the value here that can be afforded by the solar collectors is given here. Typically, what you do, this calculations is not only done for a month, but it is done for the whole year. So this has been shown here for March. This is going to be repeated for the rest of the months, and then you can combine it at the end to see generally the system that we have over a whole year, how much of the energy it is going to satisfy by solar energy. The example that we have next is the one which is showing that. The presentation is going to turn a little bit in Arabic here. So the F chart method would start by defining these two dimensionless quantities, X and, or capital X and capital Y. And here the Y is being corrected. The expression of N is already given in this slide. This is this value. X is the losses in the solar collector divided by the thermal load that we need to satisfy. Y is a representation of the energy which is being absorbed by the solar collector divided by L again, which is the load. So كلمة المجمع الشمسي, this is basically what we mean by the collector, the solar collector. Area is the area of the collector. And then FR dash is the heat removal factor, which represents the effectiveness of the collector system with heat exchanger and storage. So that tells how effective the unit is being used. And that's why here we are interested in the issue of a correction when it comes to the storage based on the size of the storage. If it is going to the standard of 75 liters per meter square of collector area, that's fine. If it is other than the 75, we have to correct it. The reference temperature that we are using here in the X expression is basically a reference temperature which is taken as 100 degrees Celsius. TA is the average air temperature. L is the load. Normally the load, if you know how much is the flow rate of hot water that you need, it's nothing but the flow rate into the specific heat into T out minus TN. So what is the current inlet temperature typically for your location and how much you need this water to be heated to? So T naught here is the target temperature that you need to get for your hot water. Tau alpha is the average transmissivity or transmittance and absorptance values. HT is the average of falling radiation on the surface of the collector. And capital N is the number of days of the year. The FR dash can be basically calculated by knowing the ratio between FR dash and FR where the equation is given here. In many cases, you'll find that this value not needed to be calculated and it is given in many cases by collectors as 0.797, 0.96, like that. So that's something that you would not always have the burden of having to calculate it. M dot is the flow rate and Cp is the specific heat of the fluid that you are using. Anyway, the values are not too difficult to calculate, but I'm just saying that sometimes the value of FR can be obtained, FR bar can be obtained just from the value of FR multiplied by a known factor. So that's something to make it a little bit simple in the calculations and not too much involved. In the case where there's no heat exchanger, this ratio is equal to 1. In the case of heat exchanger, then you would account for what is this, what is the value. And specific heat would basically be 4.2, if we're talking about water, 4.2 kilojoule per kilogram Kelvin or Celsius. And for glycol, the value of Cp is 0.85. And then surface to flow rate, that's something anyway, that we don't have to look at these numbers because these numbers are going to vary from example to the other. Again, we're talking about collectors of typically 75 liters per meter square of the collector area. If the kind of tank that you are using the storage is based on a different value, it's not necessarily 75 liters per meter squared, then you have to correct that in your calculations. And the correction factor is given here, X corrected over X is the actual storage area or volume actually that you have divided by the standard. The standard is the 75. Why this equation number 4? The reason is the calculations of the F chart method have been made originally with a value of the storage to be 75 liters per meter square of collector. So it has been taken as a standard. If you need to go for higher value or lower value, then you need to make a correction as been given here in this example or in this equation, equation 4. Then the same thing can be done for Y. If you are going to collect the dimensionless parameter x, we do correct the dimensionless parameter y, and then we substitute here, we put the equation, which is equation number 6. This equation is basically the one used for water heating or for liquid heating of solar collectors. Then this is a fraction of the solar energy of the load, fraction of the load that can be heated utilizing solar energy for that month. Then it needs to be repeated for the rest of the month so that you cover the whole year, and how to calculate the overall value of F, or the solar fraction for the whole year, it is by this equation number 7, which is given at the bottom. So F is equal to sigma Fi Li. So Fi is the monthly calculated value of F, Li is the monthly load divided by sigma Li. Does the load change from month to month? The answer is yes. And why is that? Because the temperature, the ambient temperature changes. Accordingly, the inlet water temperature that comes in changes, and then the value of the load is going to change. Accordingly, it needs to be calculated for every month. What is constant? It could be the quantity of water that you need to heat every month. But heating in summer is not like that heating in winter. The temperature or the inlet temperature of the water is affected by the ambient, and accordingly, that needs to be taken into consideration. So this is a summary of utilization of the F chart method for the calculation. As you can see here, it starts with defining the expression of capital X and capital Y, which are functions of the heat, the solar collector characteristics and the temperatures, temperature of the air, reference temperature is constant, characteristics of the collector and the falling radiation into it, the number of days of the month, the load that you need to heat. And then you would calculate the values of X and Y, correct the values of X and Y. They are functions of a corrected heat load or heat removal factor. You are going to do this corrected heat removal factor, correct the values of X and Y based on the storage that you have, and based on that, calculate the value of F for a month, repeat it for the rest of the month, and then calculate the value for the whole year. Then, definitely, when you are talking about using one collector versus two collectors versus n number of collectors, what is going to change here? Basically, what is going to change is AC, which is the collector area, which is basically the area, which is here, area of the collector. Using one collector, you may have the area as 4 meters square, two collectors will make it 8, three collectors will make it 12, and so on. Accordingly, the values of X and Y can be a function of the number of collectors this way. And accordingly also, the value of F can vary based on change in the number of collectors. Here we have a case study, which is actually a real case study of an existing hotel in Riyadh, where we need to come up with a system for heating water that the hotel is using 28,000 liters of hot water every day. They need to heat the hot water up to a temperature of 58. And it has been specified that 84 collectors, actually they were, I think they were used, they were proposed to be using Caleffi, which is an Italian company, collectors, flat plate collectors. And the flat plate collectors are having this kind of characteristics. The heat removal factor, FRUL, is 1.17 watt per meter square. The FR tau alpha is 0.42. And the correction for the angle is given here. I mean, with the ratio to the normal is given as 0.89. And the storage is 75 liters per meter square. So this is the typical, the standard collector. And the correction needed for the heat exchanger, which is which would represents basically, if I go back, it represents this kind of of terms that we have here. So FR dash over FR is given typically as 0.97, as it's and specified in the collector's characteristic sheet. And H here is, or HT is given right away as 2.74 megajoule per meter square in January. And actually, there's a table that provides the value of HT for the whole month. The factor F can be calculated based on the equations 1 and 2 that are given the values of X, capital X, and capital Y, whereas the load can be calculated from this equation here. The load, LW, L load for water heating, is the mass of the water that needs to be heated into the CP, specific heat of water, which is about 4.2 kilojoule per kilogram Celsius, T water minus a mean temperature TM into N, the number of days in the month, which is for January, they are 31. Taking an average temperature of 17.1, and we need to heat the water up to 58 degrees Celsius. So substituting this equation can give us a requested load of 101.76 gigajoules. We are talking about 48 collectors. Each collector of this Calefi is 4.05 meter square. Then the total area which is needed is a multiplication of these. When you substitute these in the values of capital X and capital Y, we are getting capital X over the area is 0.001. Capital Y over the area, I'm not sure about this value, but we are going to look at the Excel file to see whether both of them are equal or different. And we are talking about using a typical storage of 75 liters per meter square of collector area, so we don't have to correct for the storage. Then we are going to substitute into the equation of F, and you would calculate the value of F for the month of January to be 0.385, which means that 38.5% of the heating load in January is going to be given by the solar energy, and the rest is going to be given by the traditional system that you are using. It can be electric, it can be fuel burning, whatever. And accordingly, we expect the amount of energy which is going to be given by the solar energy for this application in January. This is the load, and this is the fraction. So 39.2 gigajoules are going to be provided by the solar collector system. Is that satisfactory? It depends on the economics, because the economics is basically the controlling factor in the whole calculation. Why I'm saying that? Because you are going to spend a substantial amount of payment as the capital cost of buying and installing your solar collectors, the storage, the pumps, the pipes, all of this is going to be costly, and it needs some sort of an initial investment. Then due to investments, you are going to reduce your dependence on the electric energy or the fuel, and you are going to realize some savings. These savings, how long will it take for this amount of savings are going to be combined together to compensate for the capital cost you paid? This is what we call the payback period. So, number one, what is your budget now to buy collectors? Are you going to buy how many? And this is going to get you to what type of solar fraction? And at the end, what will be the duration of time where you are going, your savings are going to cover for the capital cost that you paid, after which, after this payback period, you are really making savings. You are not paying anymore, and you are reducing the electric bill or the fuel bill that you used to pay every month earlier. This is how it's being calculated, and there are several ways to do the calculations. I'm just talking about the simplest one of them, which is called simple payback period. And that's why at certain times, the utilization of solar energy would require the governments to interfere. Interference of the governments would be to encourage people to use solar energy. And this can be done by several ways. One of them is by reducing the taxes, which is done for most countries in the world. I know, for example, in the United States, they are doing that. And in Europe, they are doing that. That you would reduce the taxes if you are using solar collectors in your system, in your heating system. Accordingly, you are making savings. You are actually not requiring the government to pay more power plants to produce electricity because you are using solar collectors. So that something is going to be a tremendous saving for the country, and that's why they do some sort of tax relaxation that you don't have to pay the whole tax, but you can pay a part of it. And that is a help, so that part of the money going for the tax, you can use it for building solar collectors. Some other countries would do something different, like especially when they are starting on the issue of solar collectors, they actually help in subsidizing the price of the solar collectors. If the solar collector is worth, for example, $1,000, they will tell you, no, you just have to pay $500 and the rest is going to be taken care of by the government. So that's another way of encouragement of governments, several governments, into the utilization of solar collectors. We will see that actually there's a table here that shows these calculations for that hotel that I talked about in Riyadh. And you are going to see here, probably it would be better if, rather than looking at this, I would just share the Excel file where the calculations have been made so that you can feel the changes that are being done into the system. Oh yes, that's the error that was in the system that in the previous slide, that X is 0.001, but Y is 0.002. This is X over the area, so that it's not just the value of X, but X and Y are given here. One of them is 0.84, and the other is 0.48. So I'm not sharing this anymore, and I'll be sharing the Excel file that has this type of calculations. This is the one, and here we have characteristics of the solar collector, the FRUL value, the FR tau alpha over tau alpha mean, storage capacity is standard as 75, and the correction factor here is taken if the F prime R is 0.97 FR. So this is basically typical values that are associated with the collector, characteristics of the collectors. Then the area of the collector here is basically coming from two things. One of them is the number of collectors. Here we are proposing 84 collectors, and the area per collector. So 4.05 into 84 will get us this area, which is 340. The correction that we have here is basically for the storage. If this value is other than 75, then this value would change. Suppose that we said that this is going to be 120. So we see the value of the correction has changed automatically. So it is based on the 75 storage. The daily consumption for this hotel is 28,000. And what I did here is just I converted it up to, this is 28,000 liters per day. I converted it into kilogram per second and it gave me that value. You need to heat the water up to 58 degrees centigrade. From what? Actually, the temperature of the water would vary from season to season between values of 23.6 up to 30 degrees centigrade. The conversion that I have here is basically a conversion between megajoule and megawatt hour. So I'm just using it as a conversion factor. And this is the kilowatt as typically given by the manufacturer of every collector is able to take care of 2.66 kilowatts of heating. Accordingly, the total kilowatt is going to be the number of collectors into the kilowattage of every one of these collectors. These values are minor calculations because it depends on the conditions that we have in the case. But this is typical values or test values. The calculations are summarized here. For every month, starting from January, February, March, April, up to December. And this is the average air temperature for each one of them for Riyadh. And this is the solar energy, kilowatt hour per meter square per day in Riyadh. The values are given here for the average month or average day of the month for every month here. These are given in kilowatt hour per meter square per day. I'm converting into megajoules per meter square using the conversion factor, and the values are given here. Number of days on the month are given here, 31st of January, 28th of February, 31st of March, and so on. So the load can be calculated, and you can see the equation of the load here in this equation bar, which is nothing but m dot into Cp into delta T, but it's being divided by 10 to the power of 6 to express it in terms of gigajoules. So the values are being calculated here for every month. And that you can see here how the load is changing. It's not changing drastically, but there's some changes here. Maybe part of the changes is that because in my calculations, I've taken the T water in as 30 and I did not change it. You may try to do it or do change it from one month to the other if you have these values, like the value, for example, in November to February, it can be 23.6, whereas the rest of the month, the value is 30. That's something that can be done. Substituting in the X equation, you can see here the values, and the value of X over the area is being calculated here, corrected, because I'm using the correction factor here, which is FR prime over FR. This is given in B5. And you know, in Excel, if I need to make my calculations, I repeat them, and I need to refer the same cell, I use the dollar sign. So that's why I'm using here dollar sign B, dollar sign one. So I need always to refer to FRUL, dollar sign B, dollar sign five. So a B5, I want to fix this cell in my calculations. That's why the dollar sign is being shown here. But the B8 is not, but because the B8 is taking care of the air temperature and it is varying. And T reference minus T air is part of the calculations. T of reference is 100, but T air is varying from month to month. And then the rest of the calculations are being taken care of here. We have the E8, which is basically representing the number of days of the month that has been considered here. F8 is basically the load that we divide by. So basically it is divided by the load for both X as well as for Y. So the value of X over the area, Y over the area. If you multiply each one of them with the area specified here, which is 340.2, then you get the X and Y. Actually, it was not necessary that I put this in repeated columns. I could have calculated X and Y right away, rather than going X over area and Y over area. That was an added thing. And then based on that, you substitute into the equation that you have for X and Y. So here we are referring to X as in column Y in column J and X in column X, and then the values are going to be calculated here for both of them. Actually it's G and I, X and Y for column J and column I. And the value of F is going to be calculated here. And then I would calculate this F fraction multiplied by the load L, because I'm going to need that in the summation at the end. I did that for January. It is being repeated in February. And you can see here, lower fraction is being given in winter, because in winter there is not effective heating coming by the sun. In summer, it is effective. And that's why the fraction increases in summer compared to winter. Anyway, what we do here, the load over the months has been summed up together to give the total load over the year. The fraction F of L calculated every month, and it's been all summed together at the end. So this is a summation of the fraction FL, and this is a summation of the load. The ratio between FL, sigma FL, and sigma L is the shape factor. So the solar fraction. So the solar fraction has been calculated in this example to be 0.59, or almost 60% of the load. The annual load, through the whole year, is given by solar energy. This is typically accepted in many, many applications, that you are reducing your electric consumption by about 60%, which is a good number. What if you needed more than that? You're going to use more collectors, that's all. So typically here, the values of the F are acceptable normally in the range between 50 to 70%. If you want to go more than that, it's all up to you. It depends on your ability to have the capital cost covered now. And definitely, if you are going to do that, then the payback period is going to be longer. Quick calculations of the payback period here is telling us that we can rectify this quantity for about 9.5 years. And here's some sort of greenhouse gas analysis. I will not talk about these because they are not an integral part of the course, but that's something that you can find a software to calculate it for you. And probably I can share with you the equations I used for the estimation of the payback period, as well as the saving in the greenhouse effect, greenhouse gases. Now, doing this and utilizing 84 collectors, we saved 100 tons of carbon dioxide for a year, which are equivalent to 230 barrels of crude oil. These have been saved over a year because we have reduced the dependence on the electricity and we have just used solar energy instead. Can you wait for 9.5 years to cover your expenses? And then, what is the lifetime of solar collector system? Typically, it's 25 years. So you buy a solar collector system and you expect it to keep on working for about 25 years with minor maintenance needed. The maintenance would be maybe every now and then you need to replace the pump. Every few years, you can replace the pump of the system, and the pumps are not that expensive. Look at this value, which is the shape factor. And look at when we change the, it's not the shape factor. I'm just, again, I'm insisting on this. F here is the solar fraction, how much energy that can be given by the solar energy compared to the total energy needed. What if we said, no, it's not 84, but I'm going to use 120 collectors. Before I do that, or before I click on this, let's look at the cost. If I assume that every collector is costing 4,000 riyals, then the total price of the collectors, if they are 84, is going to be this, 336,000 riyals. Definitely, having the solar collectors more and more utilized, they are going to make the price per unit less, and then you can have less quantity here. I know that there are, in the market here, you can find flat plate collectors that can cost as low as maybe 3,500 or so. If we do that, now what I did here is that I changed it to 120, and you can see here, it's not 60% of the load that is going to be met by the solar energy, but it's 77%. What if I need 100%? The 77% is going to cost us like that, something close to 500,000 riyal. Suppose that the price has dropped to 3,000 riyals. Then we're talking about 360,000 riyals. So this is the capital cost. Some banks can give a loan for people to do that. Some incentives from governments, whether by sharing the price, subsidizing the value, or reducing the taxes, are going to make some amount of money available for the users so that they can buy solar collectors. They don't have to buy the whole thing, but they can buy it even. Sometimes they can be satisfied with a solar fraction of 0.6 this year. Maybe next year they can buy more collectors and add them to the, based on their capabilities and plans. When can we get a 100% coverage? If we are going to use something like 180 solar collectors, you see here that the solar fraction is 99%. So as if you are relying 100% on the solar energy, but 180, it's the problem is not only the price. The problem is, where is the location where you can put 180 collectors? If you are talking about here, I'm talking about a hotel, which is huge. But this huge hotel, the roof is not necessarily empty. The roof can have air conditioned units there so that you might not have enough space to put your collectors. And that's another thing that will come, that will not come into this, this calculation method. It changes from location to location, from building to building. Sometimes the hotel is a high-rise hotel. So it's huge, the compensation is huge, but the area is not that big. So you have a limitation. You may have a parking area, and the parking area can be covered by solar collectors, but still there is a complication coming with how many pumps that you are going to need, how much are the pressure losses, and so on. So there are other dimensions that will come into it that does not give you the freedom of selecting whatever number of collectors that you want and put it in the system and say that this is what I'm going to do. Sometimes the space has certain limitation. This is basically the kind of example that I wanted to share with you regarding to the utilization of the F chart method for utilization for the use. And we have seen a couple of examples today. The first one was a rating. I have a certain collector, and then I need to see how much is the energy given by that collector for a certain month. The second one, which is this one, is a combination between rating and design, because changing the number of collectors is going to tell you that you can change your design conditions and cover more energy through solar or less, depending on your calculations. Here, I assume that the base case is electricity, while people are paying 26 halalas per kilowatt hour. This price can change. If this price increases, then basically the savings that are being done by the solar collectors are going to be better. We have something like 10 minutes left in our class. I want to please, you have already, all of you received a message from the Deanship of Academic Development that you need to evaluate the course as a part of the concentration. You all have this link?
I think it's in the email, Doctor.
Yes, please go to the email now and get into the link and do this evaluation. It's important for the university to get your feedback on the concentrations just to see what to do next. Some of the concentrations are having good feedback, so they are going to continue. Some of them would not. So the university wants to assess how do you feel about the concentration program and the courses into it. So please go ahead, use this link in the next eight minutes or so and get to that. Once you're done, just let me know.
Doctor, you mean for the CX program, yeah?
Exactly. CX is the concentration program. So please go ahead now, follow the link, and just let me know when you are done.
Okay.
I did it already.
Oh, you did it already. Fine. Who did it already? Who are you?
Abdelhadi.
Abdelhadi, okay, Abdelhadi. Then you have a nine minutes release from the class now.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. And the rest, please go ahead, start in doing this. Don't forget, just to let me know once you have completed it.
دكتور ما حصلت المسج الايميل
I don't have it. I know it was only sent to you. So يا شباب somebody has the message, can you send it to him? ما حصلتها مين ريان؟
Yes, yes, دكتور. I think it's sent before 2 days, I think. 3 days.
But I will think it was sent by the beginning of this week, maybe on
I think
Saturday or Sunday. Just check your mail. Click on the link and please go ahead and fill it.
Okay, doctor. هذه هي دكتور ارسلت لنا يوم الاحد.
يوم الاحد ها؟ طيب if you didn't find it او حد منكم ما شافهاش check your emails يوم الاحد and please press on the link.
I just completed it. Can I leave?
I completed, doctor.